Good morning, good people. Come to Thursday morning prayer. Let's get right to it today with little commentary and ramblings from me. When Christ, who is our life, appears, then we also will appear with him in glory. Open our lips, O Lord, and our mouth shall proclaim your praise. Glory to the Father, and to the Son, and to the Holy Spirit, as it was in the beginning, is now, and will be forever. Amen. Hallelujah. Give us today our daily bread. None of us lives, and none of us dies for ourselves alone. Living or dying, we belong to the Lord. Gospel reflection. Jesus, you are the bread of life. Those who come to you will never be hungry. Those who believe in you will never thirst. You are the living bread from heaven. The bread you give is your own flesh, and you give it for the life of the world. All who eat your flesh and drink your blood live in you and you in them. For your flesh is the food we need. Your blood is our salvation. All who eat your flesh and drink your blood have eternal life. Look to Jesus in the wilderness, breaking bread and feeding the multitude. The epistle reflection. Sparse sowing, meager reaping, but if we are generous, bountiful will be the harvest. So let us give what we can, not with regret, nor from a sense of duty. God loves a cheerful giver. And when we help others, we will not just meet their needs, we will unleash a flood of gratitude to God. Many will give glory to God for our loyalty to the gospel and for our generosity. God loves a cheerful giver. And we are opening our Bibles today to the book of Judges, chapter 11. If you're wondering what you missed in chapter 10, it was just this person becomes judge, the Ammonites oppress Israel. That's basically it. So chapter 11, 1 to 11. Okay. Now, Jephthah of Gilead was a great warrior. He was the son of Gilead. But his mother was a prostitute. Gilead's wife also had several sons, and when these half-brothers grew up, they chased Jephthah off the land. You will not get any of her father's inheritance, they said, for you are the son of a prostitute. So Jephthah fled from his brothers, lived in the land of Tob. He fled from his brothers and lived in the land of Tob. Soon he had a band of worthless rebels following him. About this time, the Ammonites began to wage war against Israel. When the Ammonites attacked the elders of Gilead, the elders of Gilead sent for Jephthah and in the land of Tob. The elder said, "Come and be our commander. Help us fight the Ammonites." But Jephthah said, "Aren't you the ones who hated me and drove me away from my father's house? Why do you come to me now when you're in trouble?" "Because we need you," the elders replied. "If you lead us in battle against the Ammonites, we will make you ruler over all the people of Gilead." Jephthah said to the elders, "Let me get this straight. If I come with you, and if the Lord gives me victory over the Ammonites, will you really make me ruler over all the people? The Lord is our witness, the elders replied. We promise to do whatever you say. So Jephthah went with the elders of Gilead, and the people made him their ruler and commander of the army. At Mizpah, in the presence of the Lord, Jephthah repeated what he had said to the elders. The word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Hi, Seeker. What are you doing, buddy? All right, Psalm 78. Oops. Oh, mercy. We're not doing all of 78, because that thing is forever, huh? Verses 1 through 40, which is insanely long on its own. So let's see here. Oh, my people, listen to my instructions. Open your ears to what I'm saying, for I will speak to you in a parable. I will teach you hidden lessons from our past, stories we have heard and known, stories our ancestors handed down to us. We will not hide these truths from our children. We will tell the next generation about the glorious deeds of the Lord, about his power and his mighty wonders. For he issued his laws to Jacob. He gave his instructions to Israel. He commanded our ancestors. He teached them to our children. For he issued his laws to Jacob. He gave his instructions to Israel. He commanded our ancestors to teach them to their children, so the next generation might know them, even the children not yet born, and they in turn will teach their own children. So each generation should set its hope anew on God, not forgetting his glorious miracles and obeying his commands. Then they will not be like their ancestors, stubborn, rebellious, and unfaithful, refusing to give their hearts to God. The warriors of Ephraim, though armed with bows, turned their backs and fled on the day of battle. They did not keep God's covenant, but refused to live. They did not keep God's covenant and refused to live by his instructions. They forgot what they had done, the great wonders he had. They had forgot what he had done, the great wonders he had shown them, the miracles he did for their ancestors on the plain of Zoan in the land of Egypt. For he divided the sea and led them through, making the waters stand up like walls. In the daytime, he led them by a cloud, and all night by a pillar of fire. He split open the rocks in the wilderness to give them water as from a gushing spring. He made streams pour from the rock, making the waters flow down like a river. Yet they kept on sinning against him, rebelling against the Most High in the desert. They stubbornly tested God in their hearts, demanding the food they craved. They even spoke against God himself, saying, God can't give us food in the wilderness. Yes, he can strike a rock so water gushes out, but he can't give his people bread and meat. When the Lord heard them, he was furious. The fire of his wrath burned against Jacob. Yes, his anger rose against Israel, for they did not believe God or trust him to care for them. But he commanded the skies to open. He opened the doors of heaven. He rained down manna for them to eat, and he gave them bread from heaven. They ate the food of angels. God gave them all they could hold. He released the east wind in the heavens and guided the south wind by his mighty power. He rained down meat as thick as dust, birds as plentiful as sands on the seashore. He caused the birds to fall within their camp and all around their tents. The people ate their fill. He gave them what they craved. But before they satisfied their craving, while the meat was still in their mouths, the anger of the Lord rose against them, and he killed their strongest men. He struck down the finest of Israel's young men. But in spite of this, the people kept sinning. Despite his wonders, they refused to trust him. So he ended their lives in failure. So he ended their lives in failure, their years in terror. When God began killing them, they finally sought him. They repented and took God seriously. Then they remembered that God was their rock, that God Most High was their Redeemer. But all they gave him was lip service. They lied to him with their tongues. Their hearts were not loyal to him. They did not keep his covenant. Yet he was merciful and forgave their sins and did not destroy them all. Many times he held back his anger and did not unleash his fury, for he remembered that they were merely mortal, gone like a breath of wind that never returns. Oh, how often they rebelled against him in the wilderness and grieved his heart in that dry wasteland. Luke, still in chapter 16, still talking about money, if memory serves. Until John the Baptist, the law of Moses and the message of the prophets were your guides, but now the good news of the kingdom of God is preached and everyone is eager to get in. But that does not mean that the law has lost its force. It is easier for heaven and earth to disappear than for the smallest point of God's law to be overturned. For example, a man who divorces his wife and marries someone else commits adultery, and anyone who marries a woman divorced from her husband commits adultery. Jesus said there was a certain rich man who was splendidly clothed in purple and fine linen, and who lived each day in luxury. At his gate lay a poor man named Lazarus, who was covered with sores. As Lazarus lay there, longing for scraps from the rich man's table, the dogs would come and lick his open sores. Finally, the poor man died, and was carried by the angels to sit beside Abraham at the heavenly banquet. The rich man also died and was buried, and he went to the place of the dead. There in torment, he saw Abraham in the far distance with Lazarus at his side. The rich man shouted, "Father Abraham, have some pity. Send Lazarus over here to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. I'm in anguish in these flames." But Abraham said to him, "Son, remember that during your lifetime you had everything you wanted, and Lazarus had nothing. So now he is here being comforted, and you are in anguish. And besides, there is a great chasm separating us. No one can cross over to you from here, and no one can cross over to us from there." Then the rich man said, "Please, Father Abraham, at least send him to my father's home. For I have five brothers, and I want him to warn them so they don't end up in this place of torment." But Abraham said, "Moses and the prophets have warned them. Your brothers can read what they wrote." The rich man said, "No, Father Abraham, but if someone is sent to them from the dead, they will repent of their sins and turn to God." But Abraham said, "If they won't listen to Moses and the prophets, they won't be persuaded, even if someone rises from the dead." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, Lord Jesus Christ. And so I think this last sentence is a bit ironic, right? If they won't listen to Moses and the prophets, they won't be persuaded, even if someone rises from the dead. In response to, if someone is sent to them, if someone is sent from the dead, they will repent of their sins and turn to God. Well, Jesus rose from the dead, and the same people who crucified him did not repent and turn to God. So that is a false argument. And Abraham calls him on that in the parable. Now, granted, this is a parable. It's a story. It's not history. It's not fact. It's a story that Jesus is telling to teach and make a point. And I love, my favorite part of the story, by the way, is we have this rich guy, has everything he wants, and this poor guy at his doorstep. And apparently this rich guy either never takes notice of this poor guy, never does anything to help this poor guy, probably despises the poor guy. The dogs Come and the only sympathy he gets is from dogs who lick his sores, and they both die. And when the rich guy is in the place of the dead or Hades or hell, is wherever he is, he's in a place where it is not too comfortable. And Lazarus is with Abraham and God and all the righteous in the kingdom of God. The rich man's response is, where is it? Send Lazarus, Father Abraham, have some pity. Send Lazarus over here to dip the tip of his finger in water and cool my tongue. I'm in anguish in these flames. So he's asking someone to have pity on him who has never had pity on anyone. Certainly didn't have pity on Lazarus. He's asking Abraham to have pity and send Lazarus because the rich man is in torment. When Lazarus was in torment his whole life, and this rich man never showed 1 ounce of pity. And his response, even in the situation, is not, "Oh, gee, I was wrong to not show pity to Lazarus. Oh, I could have done better, or forgive me." His response is, "Send Lazarus here to serve me. Send that poor guy who's with you in the kingdom of heaven here to hell to serve me, the rich guy." So even in the torment, he's still self-centered and focused on his own pleasure and desires. And I mean, I guess you can make the case that, well, look, he shows some other centeredness when he's worried about his brothers. Fine, he's worried about the people closest to him, maybe. But to the person who needs pity and compassion, he has no concern about. And then even in death, when he is suffering, his response to the person who was in who needed pity and compassion in life is, have him come here into hell and serve me because I am suffering. Which, again, in keeping with the gospel, should have been this rich man's response his whole life to Lazarus. He should have went to where Lazarus is and served Lazarus. That's why he had all this wealth. And I don't want to go off on a thing, and I know I'm going to offend some people by saying this, but we have this lie that we tell ourselves. It's the lie of the world. It's the lie that even Christians have come to believe, which is our stuff is our stuff. My money is my money. I work hard for my money. Why should I use it on that poor person? Why should I feed this person? Why should I give my hard-earned money to some poor person who's just going to spend it on booze? And we act like we're denying them compassion as if it is an act of righteousness. We act as if somehow not showing pity is somehow noble and righteous and faithful. And it is a lie that we are telling ourselves. Your money, beloved, I hate to break it to you, if you are a Christian, if you follow Jesus Christ, your money is not your money. It is God's money. It is Jesus's money. And God and Jesus get to use it however they want. And they give it to you so that you will use it to help others. That's why you have it, if you follow Jesus. And so if you're going to claim to follow Jesus, then you are going to claim to have nothing. And even the stuff you get to have, like I have a house. That's falling apart, but I have a house. I have food. I have all this stuff, but it's not my stuff. It's a gift I get to use until someone comes along who needs it. And then I have to figure out how I can share it with them. God gives to you so that you can give to others. And the more you give to others, God is going to give to you. I guarantee it. And if you don't believe me, try it out. Because a lot of you are just going to say that can't be true and you're never going to test it. If you want to receive from God, give to others. Give to others what you want to receive from God. If you want, this is a sermon I preach all the time. If you want to receive wealth from God, and I know that may be selfish,
But if you want to receive wealth from God, be generous with your wealth and give it to others. And it creates the flow. When God sees you using the wealth you have to help others who are in need, God is going to give you more wealth. If you want food, feed others with the food you have, and God is going to see you feeding others and give you more food. If you want health, do what you can to work for the health of others, and God is going to give you more health. Whatever you want to receive from God, there's that golden rule that Jesus says, treat others the way you want to be treated. And I say, I add to that, not that I'm anyone special, but my teaching is treat others the way you want God to treat you. Don't just treat others the way you want to be treated by them. Treat others the way you want to be treated by God. So whatever you want from God, give to others. If you want love and compassion and forgiveness, give love and compassion and forgiveness from others. Because it says that in the gospel. If you don't forgive, you won't be forgiven. If you judge, you will be judged by the same standard you use to judge others. But whatever you give, you will receive in full measure. Anyway, I was really going to move fast, but I can't stop talking. I'm Irish. And us Irish blokes, very often when we start talking, we forget how to stop. So back to the prayers. Bodhidharma is like my little alarm clock. He comes in and he's like, you know, stop talking, bro. Get back to the prayers. You're bringing me down, guy. Get back to the prayers. And then he walks off. When I start bringing back to the prayers, he's gone. He did his job. So thank Bodhi for getting me back to the prayers. So our Father, give us today our daily bread. God of seed and growth and harvest, creator of need, creator of satisfaction, give us, we pray, our daily bread, sufficient and assured for all. Give us also, we pray, the bread of life. And we shall have a care to feed the hungry and to seek for peace and justice in the world. Help us then to remember and to know that you are our life today and every day. You are the food we need now and forever. God, give us work till our life shall end, and life till our work is done. Look kindly on our world, our God, as we suffer and struggle with one another. Look kindly on your church, driven by the same necessity, and may the light we have seen in Jesus illuminate and brighten all the world. Amen. And as usual, I forgot the Franciscan Daily Companion, but then I remembered. So for June 20th, and we have a quote from St. Pius of Pietrelcina, joy with peace is the sister of charity. Serve the Lord with laughter. Oh, I like that. I'm predisposed to laughter. Joy with peace is the sister of charity. Serve the Lord with laughter. At times when Catholics leave church after Holy Mass, or we can say at times when Christians leave church after worship, they look as if they had been tortured for the past hour. We should leave church filled with the love and joy that we have just celebrated by hearing the Word of God and receiving the Eucharist. A smile can be a powerful tool for evangelization. Fill my heart with joy, O Lord, so that everyone who sees me will want to find what I have found in you. I used to always joke that the church I grew up in, which I love that church, by the way, but it is of a tradition where, you know, seems like if you're like, I think as a sort of attitude, like if you're having fun in church, you're sinning. Like somehow if you're having fun, somehow you must be sinning. So everyone in church just sort of sat there like they were constipated. That's what I used to say. So it's good. They just sit there like they're constipated the whole time. Everyone's just like, you know, other times referred to by others as the frozen chosen. But to me, they were the constipated crew. You probably didn't need to know that. Let's just jump to the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father, the Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven
is seated at the right hand of the Father, and will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. If you are listening to my comments as I go, you will begin to realize why the minister of my church, when I was called to ministry and went off to seminary, used to refer to me as the irreverent, not the reverend, the irreverent RJ. And I always thought that was a good moniker because I am the irreverent, right? Jesus says, don't call anyone reverend, or, you know, some label like that. So call me irreverent, the irreverent RJ. Oh, let's finish these prayers. In peace, let us pray to the Lord, saying, Lord, have mercy. For the Holy Church of God, that it may be filled with truth and love and be found with fault, without fault, at the day of your coming, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For our presiding bishop, our own bishop, and all bishops and all ministers and all the holy people of God, all the holy people of God, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who fear God and believe in you, Lord Christ, that our divisions may cease and that all may be one as you and the Father are one. We pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the mission of the church, that in faithful witness it may preach the gospel to the ends of the earth, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the peace of the world, that a spirit of respect and forbearance may grow among nations and peoples, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For those in positions of public trust, that they may serve justice, promote the dignity and freedom of every person, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For the poor and the persecuted, the sick and all who suffer for the poor, the persecuted, the sick and all who suffer, for refugees, prisoners and all who are in danger, that they may be relieved and protected, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For this gathering, this online gathering, and for those who are absent, that we may be delivered from hardness of heart and show forth your glory in all that we do, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For our enemies and those who wish us harm, and for all we have injured or offended, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who have commended themselves to our prayers, for our families, friends, and neighbors, that being freed from anxiety, they may live in joy, peace, and health, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. For all who have died in the communion of your church, and those whose faith is known to you alone, that with all the saints they may have rest in that place where there is no pain or grief, but life eternal, we pray to you, O Lord. Lord, have mercy. Rejoicing in the fellowship of all the saints, let us commend ourselves and one another and all our life to Christ our God, to you, O Lord, our God. O Lord, our God, accept the fervent prayers of your people. In the multitude of your mercies, look with compassion upon us and all who turn to you for help. For you are gracious, O lover of souls, and to you we give glory, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, now and forever. Amen. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. Holy and eternal God, in you we live and move and have our being. In all our cares and occupations, guide and govern us by your Spirit, that we may both remember and reveal your presence. Through our Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. Let us bless the Lord. Thanks be to God.
May the Lord direct our hearts into God's love and Christ's perseverance. Amen. Alleluia. Peace and all good, beloved. I hope you have a good Thursday, and until next time.